Good morning, Forefront. I'm Sam, and I'm so glad that you're able to join us this morning. Wherever you're worshiping from online, I hope that you and your family are doing great, staying safe, and staying well. Here at Forefront, we believe in helping people find their way back to God. And one of the ways we do that is being able to share Jesus with the community around us. Speaking of sharing, would you guys take a moment before we start this morning and share this live session, whether that's text, tweet, friends, family, whatever that is, just so that we can help share Jesus with those in the community around us. With that, speaking of Sunday morning and worship, I'm going to kick it over and kick off the morning and send it to the band.
Good morning, Forefront Church. We're so excited that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Whether you're at home or you're out across the country with your family, we just hope that you're having a wonderful, relaxing morning. And we hope that you take the time that you need to spend with God this morning in worship. Would you join with me in singing the praises of the provisions that God has provided us this morning? Walking around these walls, Smiles can't conceal you, and every glimmer is a spark, catching fire. Endless smiles can't conceal you. And every glimmer is a spark, catching fire as you break through.
Good morning, church. My name is Darren Enns, and I'm one of the pastors here at Forefront. If this is your first time watching online or connecting with us, we would love to connect with you. You can go online or download our app and fill out our connection card. We'd love to get in touch with you that way. And you can also fill out prayer requests. For those of you who normally attend Forefront, we want to pray for you and continue to do that during this COVID season. And you can fill out prayer requests as normal. You can go on the app and online as well. We have been working hard at engaging with everyone online. And we've been doing that on Facebook. We've been pushing out a lot of videos here in December, and I want to highlight one series that we'll be continuing through the new year. Drew and I have been working at putting out Wednesday afternoon devotional videos, where we want to connect with you and provide you a way to discuss with other people and to grow closer to God at the same time. And as we start the new year, we will be paralleling our new series called Reset by having a devotional series on God's calling for your life. We will also, I believe, be talking about the image of God in February. So feel free to go online on Facebook and YouTube to find those every Wednesday and watch those and connect with us in that way. So with this new series called Reset, Pastor Drew will be talking about how we can refocus ourselves in the new year and refocus on God. So be sure to tune in as we hopefully will be gathering back together soon. We know that many people use December as a time to give at the end of the year, and we want to thank everyone for partnering with our mission to Harvey Park and to the greater Denver area, especially with your finances. So time is running out to get a donation in by December of 2020, so be sure to do that soon. Remember, you can give online or by text, and you can also drop a check in the mail. Let's pray as we continue this morning's worship. Father, as we end 2020, sometimes the greatest perspective we can have on your provision for us is time. So as we look back and think about what 2020 has been, all the hardships and the struggles, it may have been great for some, but God, for the majority of us, it was tough, and it was strange, and we're not out of it yet. So God, we pray that you can continue to provide for us and be everything that we need. And as Pastor Drew gives us this message, we ask that you would open our ears and eyes to see your provision for us, and also that we can refocus on you as we enter the new year of 2021. Father, we pray this in your great and holy name. Amen.
Hey, good morning, Forefront, and Merry Christmas. I hope you guys had a great Christmas with your family, got to spend some time just gathering together, eating some great food, hopefully starting some new family traditions, and just it was a great weekend. It's hard to believe that this is the last Sunday of 2020. What a crazy year 2020 has been. I tell you, Courtney and I were just talking about this last week, that it's been 9 months since the pandemic began, and wow, who could have thought it? Just snap of a finger, it's been 9 months later. And so we're nearing the end of 2020 and just looking back on this crazy year, looking forward to 2020 and just thinking, how do we process and proceed and move forward in a year where so much has changed? And in many ways, we feel like there's just been almost like this power outage that has happened in our lives. Like we've had these setbacks, like we just push pause. And for many of us, it's gone the other direction where there's just been really hard times and some calamity and devastation. So what do we do? How do we move forward in this crazy season? And I was thinking back to a few years ago when we were still living in the Midwest, and every year we put on this really big VBS in July, and this particular year everything was really just going great. I mean, just had a great turnout from the kids and just the church, the volunteers. It was just, we were having a blast. And I remember it was Thursday of that week, and we typically ran Thursday through Friday, and this big rainstorm rolls in. And you could just see these clouds coming in. It's dark and it's ominous at like noon. And so it just starts pouring and flash floods and tree limbs are bending. And it was just crazy. And I remember we were at the church getting ready to start prepping everything for that night. And all of a sudden, whoom, power goes out. Power's completely out all over town. And we're sitting there, we light candles, just trying to kind of maneuver our way around, figuring that the power companies are going to get the power back up. And so, you know, it's 2 o'clock, it's 3 o'clock, it's 4 o'clock, you know, we're going to start at six. And we start realizing that I don't think the power's coming back on. And so we're calling, we're sending out mass texts and email, Facebook, you know, social media notifications, letting all the families know, hey guys, we're going to have to postpone VBS for tonight. And it was a super bummer. And so there's no power. We go home. We're sitting on our porch watching it rain, because in the Midwest, it rains a lot. If you're from the Midwest, you know what I mean. And it's what you do when there's no power. You sit outside and watch the rain. And it rained and it rained and it rained. And there was no power for a long time, for hours. And finally, the power came back on. And you know, we just felt, just during that time, like there's just nothing we could do. And I was thinking, that reminds me a lot of 2020. You know, we come into the beginning of 2020 and there's a lot of energy and there's a lot of passion and a lot of great things are happening in people's lives. There's a lot of great things happening in our community, a lot of fantastic, amazing things happening in our church. And all of a sudden, you know, March 13th hits and it's like the power goes out and somebody flips a switch. And the next thing we know, we're just sitting here waiting for the power to come back on. And while we wait, it's hard to accomplish the tasks that we need to accomplish. And so for 9 months, we've been kind of waiting. And there's been some flickers. You know, the summer seemed good. There were some flickers that the light was coming back on. The power was coming back, but then it goes off again. And for many families who've experienced really hard troubles, the power has been off the entire time. And there's no generator plug in. And I think all of us at some level fall on the spectrum where we either have had some setbacks, right? Setbacks at work, setbacks in relationships, setbacks financially, setbacks when it comes to some of the really good things we had going in life. There's been others who've just faced total devastation as they've lost jobs and they've lost loved ones, or their financial situation's just been wrecked. And so we all find ourselves somewhere on this spectrum, and we sit here this last Sunday of 2020 thinking, okay, what is 2021 going to look like? And I think if we're honest, a lot of us are just really tired. A lot of us are like Jackson Brown says, running on empty. And we feel powerless. We feel like the lights are off and we can't plug in. We can't recharge. And we really don't have anything to offer anymore. And I think, I don't know about you, but when that happens to me, we get this tendency to think, well, I guess I can just I'm just going to have to wait. Or I'm just going to have to shrink back and just kind of sit on my hands and wait for the power to come back on. So we feel powerless, and it causes us to disengage. We disengage from relationships. We disengage from serving others. We disengage from how God's using us in our community. And it's really hard. It's a really hard time to be in. But thankfully, God's word over and over again reminds us that when we find ourselves in these moments, when we find ourselves in these situations when we feel powerless, that's actually when we need to be looking and keeping our eyes up, because that's when Jesus is working and Jesus is the most visible. You know, it's easy when life is good and things are going great to know that, hey, Jesus is behind me. Jesus is encouraging me. Jesus is walking with me through this. But we take our eyes off of him. But it's in these moments when life is hard and things aren't going as well that we can see just the power of what God's doing. And there's these moments in life when we feel powerless and we feel like we don't have anything to offer. And those are the moments when we see Jesus shine the brightest, because we're looking for him. And those are the moments when we are humble and vulnerable, where God can use us in magnificent ways to impact the people around us. And there's a story, there's a narrative in Matthew chapter 14 that we see this very thing. We see Jesus take a situation that seemed very powerless. He took a group of people who seemed to not have much more to offer, and he uses that to do something big and beautiful and magnificent. And it just reminds us that it's in the moments like we're in right now, as we close out 2020, when we feel tired and empty and powerless, that Jesus can use us to do the most incredible things. So I want to camp out in Matthew chapter 14. And here in Matthew 14, we see one of Jesus' most amazing miracles. It's actually the only miracle that is recorded in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all record this miracle. And it's when Jesus feeds the 5,000. And this is just an amazing situation that just reminds us that God knows. It reminds us that God is inviting us into a story. So even in these moments when we're tired and the season's really hard, God's saying, come into my story. The story I'm writing, you have a part to play, and it's going to be beautiful. And what I love about this is that, again, Jesus shows us that when we feel we have nothing to give, that's when God shows up the biggest. And so Matthew 14, we see this really interesting account of this amazing miracle. So grab your Bibles. We'll be in Matthew chapter 14, and we'll start in, verse 13. Now, a little background here. Since all four gospel writers are talking about Matthew 14, this miracle, we get really this full picture of what's going on. And Mark tells us that Jesus had just sent his disciples out on a missionary journey. And so they go two by two, and they go into surrounding towns and villages, and they start talking about Jesus. And so they come back to Jesus, and they're really excited. They're just fired up about what God is doing, but they're tired, and they're exhausted. And so Jesus tells his disciples, he says, look, let's go away on a little retreat. Let's go get quiet. Let's go find some rest because you guys need rest. And so let's go get away. And so they go and they get in a boat and they're going to start rowing across the Sea of Galilee. And they're going to go find kind of a retreat, a rest for their tired souls. But then we also see something else going on here. Matthew tells us here in Matthew 14 that Jesus learns right when they're getting ready to go on this retreat and go rest. And he tells us that John the Baptist had died. And if you know the story of Jesus and John the Baptist, they were second cousins. They, we believe, knew each other really well. We don't really have a whole lot of account of their life, but I think they were probably spent some time. Maybe John, you know, and Jesus spent some great time together. I believe they were close friends. And we see that here as that when Jesus finds out that John had lost his life to King Herod, Jesus is mourning, and it hits Jesus hard. And so we also see, Luke tells us that now King Herod wants to find Jesus. So King Herod's coming after Jesus now because he wants to talk to him. And so now Jesus is mourning his friend. He's got this pressure. The king's coming after him. His disciples are all worn out, weary, and tired. And now they're trying to go get this retreat. And so we find ourselves in Matthew chapter 14, verse 13. And Matthew says this. He says that in verse 13, now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. So Jesus is mourning the loss of his friend. And he's trying to go on this retreat with his disciples and give them some rest and find a quiet place for them to kind of clear their heads and have, you know, their souls nurtured to and ministered to by God. But what I think in just this one little verse, what we see here is this beautiful picture that Jesus understands our need for rest. I think Jesus understands that there's these times when we're going to be emotionally spent, we're going to be exhausted, we're going to feel like we have nothing left, we're going to be running on empty. And it's in those moments that Jesus is saying, look, we need to go find rest. We need to go withdraw to some desolate place and have God give us rest. Some of you watching this, you guys have been running really hard. You guys have been worrying a lot. You guys have been carrying around a burden and anxiety for a long time. And I think what Jesus was saying to you is, I understand. I understand that's hard. And I understand you need rest. So come and find your rest in me. See, some of us, we need to turn off the news. And we need to put down our phones. And we need to turn our email, close our laptops and shut down our email and not check it for a day. Some of us need that a day just to rest and to have our souls nurtured to. I tell you, a couple weeks ago, I was feeling that. I was just feeling worn out. Everywhere I was going, I was just feeling like there's just so much coming at me all at once. And I just, to be honest, just kind of took a day and said, I just got to close it all down and rest. Jesus did something beautiful, nurtured to my soul. You need that. Many of you need that right now because you're worn out, you're exhausted, you feel empty, and you feel powerless, like you don't have anything to give. Just know, Jesus understands that. And so Jesus comes to give you rest. That's what he says in Matthew 11, 28, that when you're weary, you're heavy laden, come to me, Jesus says, because I can give you rest. It's what you need right now. So Jesus understands and he gets that. Now notice what happens in the story in Matthew 14. So Jesus and his disciples, they're in the boat. They're getting ready to go on this retreat. They're pulling away. But all of a sudden they look over to the shore and they see there's this huge crowd that's actually following them along the side of the lake or the Sea of Galilee. And they look over and they see all these people. And I'm sure the disciples are thinking, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? Like, we were literally in the car driving into the mountains on the way to Bailey or on the way to Crested Butte where we were going to camp or we were going to set up and rent a hotel and rest, get a VRBO or an Airbnb and rest for a couple days. And now we're driving there and we see all these people. Like, you got to be kidding me. But something really awesome happens here. Something really beautiful. Notice this. So they look over, they see the crowd that had followed them on foot. You know, the crowd knew of Jesus. He was the one that was healing the sick and giving sight to the blind and helping the deaf hear. And they wanted to be near him. So this huge crowd's following Jesus. And then we see in verse 14, and he went ashore, they pulled their boat up to the shore and he saw this great crowd. And notice this, that he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Notice that word compassion. That word compassion is really kind of an interesting word. That Jesus knows that they need this rest, and Jesus is having their rest interrupted, but he doesn't get upset about that. He doesn't get mad. He doesn't say, come back on Monday. He doesn't send me an email. He says, you can wait on a TPS report. No, Jesus has compassion on them. This word compassion is really interesting. Because I think a lot of times you and I think about compassion, we think about this kind of emotion, this feeling, right? This, like, oh, bless his heart, let me help. But really, it's actually a physical term for, like, this physical experience. And so it's translated to be moved in your inward parts. So Jesus, like, feels this, like, unction, this, like, stirring up, this actually physical pain in his stomach for these people. He's compassion. He says, I need to do something for these people because these people need me right now. Yeah, I'm tired, I'm exhausted, and I'm worn out, and my guys need some rest. But you know what? These people need us more than we need that right now. And so Jesus pulls the boat up, and Matthew says that they go and they heal the people. That Jesus goes and he starts ministering to these people. And there's something powerful here for you. There's something really powerful here for me, and it's that Jesus shows us compassion when we're in need. You know, it'd be really easy for Jesus to say, hey, come back. Really easy for Jesus to say, hey, I'm going to show you something later. But Jesus is showing us that he shows compassion when we have these needs. Let me ask you a question. When you have a need, when you have a physical need, maybe you're emotionally spent, maybe you're hurting. Maybe there's something going on as a situation in life and you just feel empty. What do you think happens when you take that to Jesus? Well, I mean, how do you think Jesus is going to respond? You know, Jesus isn't that kind of guy that's just going to say, hey, you need to tighten up your bootstraps and go. I mean, we see right here that Jesus, he is compassionate, that he responds to us with grace, that he responds to us with mercy. And right now, this is clear evidence that Jesus moves towards us when he sees that we have needs. See, right now, Jesus knows that you have needs. Right now, Jesus knows that there are families out there that are going through difficult situations and that we have needs. And Jesus leans into us. He comes towards us, that he has compassion for us. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever feel like Jesus doesn't care. Like you're just in this place where you just don't know what's going on and you don't know what it's going to look like on the other side and you feel like you're empty and powerless and tired. Jesus knows that and Jesus cares. And Jesus will come to you. He will step off the boat and come to you and care for you in that moment. Take that to the bank, church. We can rest in that. And we can rest in Jesus. Notice verse 15. Notice what Jesus does next. In verse 15, it says, now, when it was evening, meaning that the disciples had been after it a whole day. The whole day, they're in this crowd of people mixing up with them and ministering to them and caring for them and healing them and loving on them for the whole day. Whole day without anything to eat, too. And these guys are going, you got to be kidding me. I'm so tired. I thought we were going on this retreat, but we're here with Jesus. We're doing what Jesus asked us to do. Now, notice this. They said, now when it was evening, the disciples came to him, to Jesus, and they said, this is a desolate place. We're out in the middle of nowhere, and the day is over. Send the crowds away into the villages so they can go and buy for themselves some food. So, like, Jesus, look, let me just let you know that it's the end of the workday and that we're tired, we're hungry. This crowd hasn't had anything to eat all day. They're tired and they're hungry. We need to send them up. Send them out, wrap this thing up, and go let them get some dinner because we're all going to starve to death. We're so hungry. But notice what Jesus says to them. This is great. This is so good. He says in verse 16, but Jesus said to them, they don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. It's like, what? Hold on. What, Jesus? We've got this massive crowd. We're in the middle of nowhere, and you are telling us that we need to go and give them something to eat. Like, how are we going to do this? And this is the start of one of the most amazing miracles that Jesus gives us in the entire Bible. This is beautiful. And it shows us that Jesus it invites us into a story and that Jesus invites us into his mission. That Jesus is inviting you and Jesus is inviting me to be a part of his mission. I mean, notice this. This is so cool. Put yourself in this place, right? You're tired. You're hungry. You're looking at this crowd and you're not seeing any McDonald's. There's nothing around you. There's no King Supers. There's nothing. And then Jesus tells you, hey, we need to go give these people something to eat. Jesus is saying, look, we need to go on a Costco run and we need to go buy enough food to feed an arena full of people. And so the disciples, their heads are spinning. And they're going, what's going on? I don't really know what to do. And John tells us that Philip pulls out a scientific calculator and starts doing the math. And he says, Jesus, like 200 denarii worth of bread won't even feed all these people. Now, a little context, that's a year's worth of wages. And which is about what a true Costco run is going to cost you these days. Jesus is telling them to go feed the people, and Philip's going, Jesus, like, we don't have enough money to buy this. And plus, Judas is holding tight to the money bag like Chevy Chase to a gutter, and there's nothing we can do here. But Jesus knew what he was getting ready to do, and he was just teaching them to trust him. He was just teaching them to believe in him and what he was getting ready to do. And so Jesus tells the disciples, go and find what we have. See what we have. And so Andrew, Peter's brother, finds this boy who's got some food. And so Andrew's like, hey, there's a boy over here who's got two fish and five little loaves of bread, probably little bread rolls. And Jesus is like, okay, grab that and bring that here to me. Now, I'm sure this boy is like, hold on a second. Am I the only person out of all these people here that literally brought a lunch, that packed something? Is it just me? You know, this boy must have been an Eagle Scout, right? And so he's just, I guess he was prepared. And this is amazing what happens here. This is so good. So Jesus sees this really small amount of food and he's going to show us something amazing. And so Jesus says to him, he says, okay, bring them here to me. See, here's the point. A lot of us think that what we have to give is nothing. That what we have to give is this little small, measly, pathetic little gift. These little two fish and five rolls. It's just barely enough for me. It's not enough for somebody else. But Jesus is teaching us a lesson here. Jesus is showing us that what may seem pathetic and insignificant in your hands actually is beautiful and significant when placed in the hands of the King. See, what we have may seem small, but when we place it in the hands of Jesus, it's huge. You see, it all depends on whose hands it's in. We feel powerless right now. We feel like we don't have anything to give. Jesus is saying, trust me, you have plenty to give. And this is a beautiful picture because think about it like this. Jesus could have fed this crowd in a number of ways, right? Jesus could have rained down manna from heaven like we see in the book of Exodus. Jesus could have brought quail in and they could have had duck hunt heyday. Jesus could have had the what would Jesus do food truck back up and have everybody get some really good grilled cheese, but he decided not to do that. He wanted to teach them a lesson about faith and about what we give to him, he can turn in and multiply into something beautiful and greater than we could ever imagine. So, notice what he does. Luke tells us that Jesus tells his disciples to then go and take this crowd of people and have them sit in groups of 50. Now, commentators will say that there were 5,000 men here, but when you add in women and children, there's probably upwards to 20,000 people. So imagine you're at an avalanche game and it's packed at Ball Arena, the old Pepsi Center. It's packed. And you're at the game, and you're telling a group of really hungry hockey fans, which hockey fans can get pretty hangry. Trust me, I know a few. You're telling a huge group of people, okay, sit down in groups of 50, right? So like the disciples, they're going through 20,000 people saying, hey, sit in groups of 50. That had to be exhausting. And then people are saying, hey, what are we going to eat? What's for dinner? And they're going, I don't know, some chips, some fish and chips. Maybe it's a home-cooked meal. I'm not really sure. There's just this kind of this moment. And I just imagine as they're doing this, Jesus kind of got this smile on his face. He's got this smile on his face because he knows what's getting ready to happen. And then notice verse 19, Matthew 14, 19. He says then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and he said a blessing. He said grace. And then he broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds. Now this is cool. We don't really know what this looked like. We don't know if Jesus said pow and now there's enough food for 20,000 people. I don't get the feeling that's what it is. I get the picture that as the disciples are going out and they're distributing food, they come back and there's more. And they're going out and they're delivering more food to another group of 15, they come back and there's more. And every time they go out, there's more. And every time they come back, there's more. And I think Jesus got this kind of grin on his face because he's seeing their faith grow. He's seeing that they're believing that Jesus is providing, that Jesus is feeding 20,000 people off the food for a boy. And their faith is coming alive because they see what Jesus is doing. And friends, this is what faith looks like. See, a lot of times when God calls us to be obedient, we don't know what it's going to look like. And we don't know if it's going to work. And we don't know how it's going to come together. But then when we start being obedient and just doing it, doing what Jesus asks us to do, something amazing happens because we start to see it's coming together. And our faith grows. And we do a little more. And our faith grows. And we do a little more. And our faith grows. See, Jesus is inviting you and I in to be part of his story. He's inviting you and I to be a part of this mission together. And he says, look, you're not going to have all the answers. You're not going to know how it's all going to work. You're not going to know what 2021 is going to look like. But trust me, have faith, be obedient, do what I say is best for you, and you're going to see it's going to work out, and your faith is going to grow, and it's going to be beautiful. See, I think the point Jesus wants you and I to take away today is this, that we're not going to have all the answers. And we're going to feel like we don't have much to give. But when it's in the hands of Jesus, Jesus does all the heavy lifting. That Jesus is the one that delivers. That Jesus is the one that multiplies. Not you or not me. It's Jesus. And he's the one that provides. So what Jesus is telling us, he's inviting us to do, he's saying, I have the power. You may feel powerless, but you're not. Because in me, I have that power. So Jesus tells us this. He says, bring what you have to him and share what he gives you with others. He says, bring what you have to me, no matter how big, no matter how small, bring it to me. And then take what I give you and share it with others. So I think one of the realities of the season we're in is that you and I, we look around at what we have and we think, I don't have much to offer. I don't have much to give. And we kind of got this habit to hold on tight. We kind of want to wrap our arms around the little that we have left. Or we look and we say, man, I don't have anything. I don't have anything to give. And so I'm just not going to do anything. I'm not going to give anything. I'm going to kind of shrink back and kind of fall back because I'm tired and I'm lacking hope and I'm worn out and I'm empty and I don't feel like I have any power. But Jesus says, don't count how much you have. Jesus says, don't try to justify what you should do based on what you have, because you're never going to feel like you have enough. Just bring what you have. This boy had 2 fish, 2 little fish, and 5 little rolls of bread. And Jesus took that and multiplied that to enough to feed 20,000 people. Jesus says, look, whatever you have, my friend, bring it, because it is enough. Because it is enough. And then Jesus says, whatever it is, bring it. See, you may not feel like you have many resources right now. And you may not feel like you have been given great gifts. And you may not feel like you have influence or you have connections or that you have anything to offer. And Jesus says, you do. That whatever you've been given, bring it. Because it's enough. And when you bring it, even if it is something that seems insignificant, Jesus will show you that it is significant. And he will turn that into something big and beautiful and amazing that he can bless people with, that he can change the world with. And it was all because you brought your two fish and your five loaves. And you brought it and you said, Jesus, here it is. You put it in his hands. In your hands, it wasn't much. In his hands, it's so much. It's more than enough. What would it look like if you and I took what we have, no matter how small it is, no matter how meager we feel it is, we took what we have and we said, here it is, Jesus. I am going to entrust you with this. Here is what I have, whether it's resources, it's time, it's talent, it's treasure, no matter what it is, I'm going to say, Jesus, here it is, use it. And use it for your good. So Jesus says, bring what you have, but also Jesus says, share what you get. Jesus is saying, whatever you get back, or whatever you get from Jesus, share it with others. Just like the disciples, they're going out and distributing food, and they come back, and there's more food. And they take it, and they share it, and they come back, and there's more food. So I think Jesus is saying, share what you have. And you might say, well, I don't know what I have. Jesus has given us so much. We just have to look for it. You know, if Jesus has given you wisdom, share it. Share it with others. Open God's word and share what he's teaching you to others. If Jesus has given us grace, tell others about that grace. Share that with others. If Jesus has given you resources, share those resources with others. If Jesus has given you certain spiritual gifts, no matter how big or how small they are, share those too. Give those to others. You know, just think, what if that became our prayer as we end 2020 and we started 2021? That our prayer was just simply, Jesus, I give you everything I have. And anything you give back, I'm going to share that with others for their good and for your glory. Like, what if that literally was our prayer every day on our lips? Jesus, I'm going to bring you what I have and I'm going to share with others what I get. How could God use that, what we think small and insignificant, to change this community and this culture and your workplace and your family and our church and our neighborhood? How could God use that to change the world? I think God could do amazing things, but we have to humbly come before him and realize, I may not have much, but what I have in the hands of the King is enough. We got to bring that to him and lay that at his feet. And notice what happens. Look at verse 20. This is great as we wrap up this text. Verse 20, notice what happens. Matthew says in verse 20, and they all ate, 20,000 hangry people ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of the broken pieces left over. And those who ate were about 5,000 men besides women and children. They were satisfied. What Jesus brought was enough. And I think for us, it's just a reminder that everything Jesus gives will be enough. That in Jesus, we can be satisfied with what he's given us because it's always enough. And we can nibble on the world and we can load up on little snacks here and there, but it's never going to be enough to satisfy us. But what Jesus gives, when Jesus takes a little and makes a lot, it's always enough. A couple years ago, we took a team down to Guatemala and we had learned that we were going to minister to a group of families that had really been fallen on really difficult challenges, really difficult times, really hard situations. And so the group that we were going with decided they wanted to make care kits for the women, for these moms. And so they brought together these beautiful care kits and hygiene products and toothbrushes and shampoo and conditioner and lotion and all these things. But then they wanted to do something special. So we took as much as we could get, and they started to make their own perfume and their own bug spray because it's hard to get down there. It's Guatemala. It's rainforest. You know, it's just, there's a lot of mosquitoes. And so they said, we're going to make our own bug spray. We're going to make our own perfume because that's just expensive. And it's hard to get their hands on. And so we made up as many kits as we could get. We brought together all the resources we could. We brought what we had so that we could share what we had been given. And so we go down to Guatemala. We probably have about 40 kits. And so we're at the day that we're going to distribute them to the women. And we've got this huge crowd that we're in this open air church with a roof. And we've got this huge crowd that's coming to listen. And so Courtney teaches a lesson about Jesus and his love for us. And then we're at this point where we're going to distribute these care kits to the ladies. And we see this line form, and this line was long. And I thought, we had 40 kits. I swear there's 100 people in this line. And we start to have people come up, and we give them a kit, and God bless you, we're praying for you, and share a kind word. And we start to see the line coming, and we're giving kits, and it's just an amazing moment. Like, our hearts are just so full. We're so fired up right here. But I'm lacking faith. I'm looking at this line going, we're not going to have enough kits. We're not going to have enough kits. I'm worried. But Jesus took what we had. We brought to Jesus what we had. And there was enough. We get all the way to the end of the line and we look and there's one bag left. And then there's this sweet older lady walking down. I look behind her, nobody left. Somehow, every single woman there who wanted a bag, who wanted a care kit, got one. And we had exactly enough. We took what we had, gave it to Jesus, didn't feel like it was much, but gave it to Jesus, and somehow there was exactly enough. And that's what Jesus does. Jesus takes what we give him, and there's always enough. There's always going to be enough. And it's just this beautiful picture that we can trust him, that when we bring what we have to him, he's going to use it every single time, and it's going to be beautiful. And so Jesus says, just bring what you have to me and then share what you get with others. And when you do that, you're part of my story and you're joining me on mission, and I'm going to use you to change the world. Forefront, as we close up 2020, I just want to end with just a reminder that Jesus knows. Jesus knows that we're tired. Jesus knows that we're worn out. Jesus knows that we're exhausted. And Jesus is here to give us rest. Jesus knows that we need to be filled, and Jesus is here to satisfy us. But as part of this, Jesus is saying, trust me. And in faith, don't fall back. Don't give up. Don't run and hide, but instead step towards me. Bring me whatever you have. And I'm going to turn that into something beautiful. So my prayer for us is that as we end 2020 and step into this new year, we can pray to Jesus and say, Jesus, here's what I have. I'm giving it to you, and I'm going to share what you've given to me with everybody I know. And when we do that, we can be assured that Jesus is going to change the world through you and through me. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for just the amazing miracle that Jesus fed the 5,000. And in this miracle, he teaches us so much. He teaches us so much about how he sees our need. And Jesus, he has compassion on us. And Jesus came to give us rest and to fill us up and to invite us into his story. Father, I know that we're just going through such a challenging season, but I pray use your word to sink deep in our hearts and help us to see that you've called us into this mission, that you've invited us to be a part of your story. So we just need to play our part. And when we do, we will be amazed at the way our faith grows, because we'll see Jesus moving through our lives, through our situations, each and every time. So Father, as we wrap up this crazy year and look forward to the uncertainty of the year ahead of us, help us to remember that Jesus knows, that Jesus cares, that Jesus is here, and that he is always near. So Father, draw us closer to you and help us to become the people that you have created us to be. And we ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Hey, Forefront, as we close out 2020, there's no better way for us to end the year than with communion. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11 that when we take communion together, we're retelling the story of what Jesus did for us and proclaiming it until he comes again. And so now's a great time to run to your kitchen and grab your prepackaged communion cup and go ahead and start working on the top, or to go grab some bread and a cracker and some juice. There's nothing magical about the elements, But it's just this act of us coming together to remember what Jesus did for us. The night Jesus was arrested, he was having the Passover meal with his disciples, and they were sitting down at the table. In Matthew 26, we read this. As they were eating, Jesus took a small loaf of bread and blessed it and broke it apart and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take it and eat it, for this is my body." So if you want to grab your cup or your bread or cracker, Jesus said, "Take and eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." Just after that, Jesus took a cup of wine and he gave thanks for it, and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "Each one drink from it, for this is my blood sealing the new covenant. It is poured out to forgive the sins of the multitudes." Jesus says, "Mark my words, I will not drink this wine again until the day I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." We do this in remembrance of Jesus. Forefront 2020 has been a really interesting year, but I know God is with us. In 2021, he's going to be right by our side, and he's going to lead us to a beautiful place together for his glory and for our good. I love you, and I'll see you soon. Blessings.
Hey everyone, thanks so much for joining us this morning. It was great to be able to worship with you online. We know that during this season, it can be a little bit crazy and we want to make sure we're staying connected. So head on over to our website, make sure you download our app and fill out the connection card and keep that updated for us, as well as fill out any of the prayer requests or praises that you might have. If you need prayer, please reach out and let us know. The team would love to come together and be praying for you during this time. Just want to say thanks again. It was great worshiping with you. We cannot wait to see you again in person. Love you, be safe, and take care.